So just first off, by way of business, I apologize for the mistake in the syllabus. I don't think I've done that before. But you'll note that we went September 21st, 23rd, then back to 22nd and 28th. So I appreciate that was brought to my attention this weekend. So we're not going to talk about Aboriginal rights today and their limits, meaning that pages 150 to 178 are not examinable for the exam, although there is a PowerPoint presentation on the course space that covers the cases that are part of those readings. And we're going to be starting with the historic Aboriginal title today, moving on to Delgamuukw on Wednesday and Chilcotin next Monday. So in other words, the syllabus continues as it is, but I'm sorry for that mistake. And even when I sent out the correction, I said it's not examinable from pages 15 to 178. I meant 150 to 178. So sorry about that. So today we're going to talk about title. And so we've had three classes dealing with governance and three classes dealing with rights. And now we're going to have three classes dealing with Aboriginal title before we get four classes dealing with treaties. And the order of discussion today is indicated here in the PowerPoint. First of all, we're going to talk about Indigenous peoples' relationships to land. Then we're going to be talking about Aboriginal title and the law of nations. And then finally, we'll look at the early cases dealing with Aboriginal title in Canada, the St. Catharines Milling and Lumber Company case versus the Queen and the Calder case. We start with Indigenous relationships to land because we're continuing to remind ourselves that Aboriginal title isn't just sourced in the common law world. It also has one of its roots, Indigenous peoples' own relationships to land. And so I thought about what are some of the ways that people express their relationships to land? How does Aboriginal title, from an Aboriginal perspective, perhaps get characterized? And one of those points that we've been emphasizing time and again in this course is that Aboriginal peoples often see their creation as peoples in the places that they're currently located. And so we talked about the turtle story, the great turtle coming up from the depths as the Anishinaabe understanding of their relationship to land. And we even talked about Mishimakinakon, Mishilimakinak, as being the center place of the Anishinaabe homelands. And then there was the story about the Cree and the little mole deciding and helping to understand where the gift of knowledge and justice would be housed. And there was a lot of discussion in that story about the prairies with the buffalo and the mountains, etc. And then last class, when we dealt with the Vanderpeet case and maybe even the Sparrow case before that, we talked about the Hulkaminum creation stories with those who fell from the sky and the ancestors and the Transformer characters that are just marked on the land. You know, if you look at the mountains all around this area, they are named mountains. They're named after characters who live from time before memory. Mount Maxwell, for instance, on, I guess that's Salt Spring Island, is got a name. The name of Mount Baker is a part of that story. There's Mount Prevost, etc., etc. You'll find that the creation is a way of not talking about meets and bounds in a Western property law context, but nevertheless talking about their relationships to that place. Which raises the second point, which is the time depth that people associate with their residence in their territories. This time depth is obviously very significant for many people. They have their oral histories that extend back, you know, to creation, but even the archaeological evidence places them there, you know, 15,000 years in the past. And there was some interesting discussion in the Calder case about this. There was on page 227, Gideon Minescu of the Niska in 1915, when talking to a Royal Commission said, we haven't got any ill feelings in our hearts, but we're just waiting for this thing to be settled, and we've been waiting for the last 5 years. We have been living here from time immemorial, and it has been passed, handed down in legends from the old people, and that is what hurts us very much, because the white people have come along and have taken this land away from them. I myself am an old man, and as long as I have lived, my people have been telling me stories about the flood, and they did not tell me that I was only to live here on this land for a short time. We have heard that some white men have been in Ottawa. This white man said that they must be dreaming, that they own this land which they live on. It is not a dream. We are certain this land belongs to us. Right up to this day, the government never made any treaty, not even to our grandfathers or our great-grandfathers. Right? So the quote there is that we have been here since time immemorial. And we never remember giving this away to anyone. And people who have come subsequently have only been there 5, 10, 100 years, a very short time in the sweep of the relationship that Indigenous peoples have had with the territories. So that's a significant part of thinking through Indigenous concepts of land and their relationship with the land. There's also this idea of identity. The fact that the land is the people. It's sometimes the case in the Aboriginal languages that there is no distinction between talking about land and talking about people. It's a little bit like the Hebrew Adam, which I think means dirt or earth. If there's something about the person being named or the community being named that picks up on the land itself and people regarding themselves as a part of the land. So when for instance, the Gitxsan were talking about their territory, they were talking about if a piece of it gets cut off, it's like cutting off their leg or cutting off their arm. Right? Because their land is them, it's a part of them. It's not necessarily totally separated from them. There's also this idea of kinship, being in a relationship with the earth that sees the earth as a brother, a sister, a mother. In the Anishinaabe world, we talk about Mishikamikwe, which is Mother Earth, and the fact that the earth is the mother and that brings forth life for everyone else to be able to live on. This is Basil Johnson, who I mentioned passed away now about 3 weeks ago, wrote this. This principle of equal entitlement precludes private ownership. No man can own his mother. This idea of owning your mother would be contrary to an understanding of these kinds of relationships. This principle even extends into the future, he says. The unborn are entitled to the largesse of the earth, no less than the living. During his life, a man is but a trustee of his portion of the land and must pass it on to his children what he has inherited from his mother. At death, the dying leave behind the mantle they occupied, Basil leaving behind his body, taking nothing with them but a memory and a place for others still to come. Such is the legacy of man, to come, to live, to go, to receive in order to pass it on. Again, he says, no man can possess his mother. No man can own the earth. Men and ages linger and then pass on. Mother Earth remains whole, indivisible, and enduring. With death ends ownership and possession. Men do not outlive the earth. Earth outlasts man. You can see the last concept also evident in this quote, the idea of stewardship. And not just that humans are stewards for the earth, but the earth is also a steward for humans. Which brings us to that next point of animacy. The earth as a living being, as a mother, as a kin, as a being, as part of your identity, has a life in it, is living. Is, you know, James Lovelock in the 1970s developed this Gaia thesis of the earth as a living organism. Well, the Anishinaabe, other peoples have this idea of the earth as a living being, such that not only do we exercise a stewardship in relationship to the earth, but the earth exercises stewardship in relationship. We are dependent on the earth. If the earth didn't fulfill her stewardship, we would no longer be able to sustain ourselves in these places. I didn't have you read this, but on 183 of the materials, there's a quote from John Snow, who is Assiniboine, Stoney, in the foothills of the Rocky Mountains there, just outside of Calgary. He says this: "Our Mother Earth called us from the forests, the prairies, the valleys, the mountainous areas, the lakes and the rivers and streams. Come, my children, anyone who is hungry, come and eat from the fruits and gather from the abundance of this land. Come, everyone who thirsts, come and drink pure spring waters that are especially provided for you. Everywhere the spirits of all living things were alive. We talked to the rocks, the streams, the trees, the plants, the herbs, and all nature's creations. We called the animals our brothers. They understood our language. We, too, understood theirs. Sometimes they talked to us in our dreams and visions. At times they revealed important events or visited us on our vision quests to the mountaintops. Truly, we are a part of and related to the universe, and these animals were a very special part of this creation." This idea of animacy being expressed there. In many languages in indigenous worlds, the world, the land, is identified as being living. You can't describe the land without describing it in those terms. So for instance, if you were to learn Anishinaabemowin, you would learn what's animate and what's inanimate. So when you learn French, right, you learn what's feminine and masculine. We don't have that gender division. We have an animacy-inanimacy division. And our body, for instance, is mostly dead. If you were to describe the different parts, you would describe them in terms that are inanimate. Nick with my arm, Nikad with my leg, Nishtaguan my head, those are all inanimate things. There is something animate in humans, it's called Chijak, which is the spirit within that allows the body to have an animation. The only thing, not the only thing, but a very few things are living on a human body. The woman's reproductive organs are living in the language because they mimic the earth. They bring forth life. But other than that, it's mostly just an inanimacy. But when you come to the earth and you describe a rock, in many of the dialects of Anishinaabemowin, a sinik, plural, would be to describe a living being. So imagine having a legal system that endows agency in the things that in English we consider inanimate. And imagine then trying to do something as human beings to a piece of ground that's animate without their permission or without their involvement. Imagine trying to subject the rocks to your will without their involvement. And in some way, that could be like slavery, right? Putting another being to your use without their active involvement. And so when treaties were signed across the prairies or in my territory, pipes were often spoken and prayers offered and discussions and listening to, as John Snow was saying here, listening to the earth and asking for permission for other people to come and live amongst us and share those places. Because it wasn't just up to us as Anishinaabe or Cree or other people to say, here, go ahead, live there. It was also up to the rocks and the earth itself to extend that kind of permission. This idea of animacy, of rocks as living, as the earth as living, of course, would just color your very view. You can't even speak about the world. It's not just a philosophical concept. It's hardwired into the way you think about pronouns and, you know, personality, to be able to look out at the world in that way, which is the need often then for the ceremonial component, to try to find ways to listen, reach out, understand, express the relationships of that knitting together of worldviews. So when we say, when we're dealing with Aboriginal title, that a morally and politically defensible conception of Aboriginal rights would incorporate both perspectives, both the common law and the Indigenous perspective, we're saying a lot, because we're trying to pull in these kinds of understanding, and property law alone just doesn't quite capture what's going on there. Of course, these aren't determinative when you come to Aboriginal title under Western law. They're helpful by way of analogy. Likewise, the common law is not determinative. You know, the meets and bounds and alienability and transferability, exclusivity of the common law, that's also not determinative, although it can be very helpful by way of analogy. We are talking about inter-societal law here, as we've already discussed with the framework of Section 35, when we're talking about this bridging function between legal systems, and so we just need to keep that on our agenda. Any questions or comments about that side of the equation? Okay, so now we're going to go to the other side of the equation and look at where the common law comes from in trying to understand its relationship to these territories here, particularly in North America. And on the background there is a picture of Manifest Destiny, like an angel leading the settlers across the lands of North America. And you can see, people walking and hand-covered carts and stagecoaches and then trains falling behind there, and then commerce behind that. Lady Manifest Destiny leading Europeans across a continent almost in a divine fashion. And what you get on the front end of that, of course, is the Indians receding as all of this so-called progress and civilization works its way through the land. This is often one of the views that the Puritans brought across with them when they came to North America. They regarded this land as a new Jerusalem, as being set apart for a new kind of religious experience to take root, and they regarded themselves as a city set on a hill, and that they needed to bring with them this sense of divine favor. And a part of that is wrapped up with a doctrine that then eventually becomes known as the doctrine of discovery. So when that first settler puts his foot on the shores of the land on the Atlantic Ocean or sails up the St. Lawrence River, whenever that first settler puts his foot down, all of that land becomes transformed. That foot going down makes the title, the crown's title, on behalf of the person who was bearing the flag of the particular nation that they're walking with. This idea of the doctrine of discovery we already encountered in the Sparrow case when Justice Dixon said there was from the outset never any doubt that underlying title and sovereignty vested in the crown. Well, how did the crown get underlying title? Why was there from the outset never any doubt about this? Because that foot going down with Manifest Destiny behind it transformed the character of the land as it was owned or related to. Now, of course, there's a problem with that, right? Because if anyone had discovered these lands, it was the Salish and Mi'kmaq and Blackfoot and Lakota, Dakota, Passamaquoddy, Innu, Montagne, etc., etc. In other words, if we were to think about the doctrine of discovery without discriminatory terms, we would recognize that there were already people there that had discovered it. And they would get the benefit of this doctrine. But in the Law of Nations, the doctrine of discovery reads indigenous peoples often out of that equation. They weren't high enough on the scale of so-called civilization to be able to possess that land. And therefore, others could discover it because they were too primitive. Indigenous peoples were too primitive in their pre-contact state to be able to claim that. So that's the doctrine, but then the doctrine, if interpreted in a non-discriminatory way, just doesn't hold. Well, there's this other idea. Well, maybe we, the Crown says, didn't get this right through the doctrine of discovery, but we eventually moved in. And in moving in through our occupation of the land, we're able to secure a title to that land. But that's just moving the goalposts back a little bit, because again, it was still an occupation before Europeans arrived. We talked about the hundreds of thousands of people that lived around the southern Ontario area, the close to 100,000 people that lived around the Salish Sea area. It was already occupied. Sometimes this is talked about the earth in this continent being terra nullius. Terra, earth, nullius, without inhabitant, empty land. But of course it was occupied, and so that has problems with it on its face. Well, there's this next doctrine, which is, well, maybe discovery is not quite right, or maybe occupation doesn't do it alone, but we've possessed this land for a period of time such that that dispossesses you as the prior inhabitants of the earth. This in property law is known as the doctrine of prescription, adverse possession. You know, if you're in possession of land for maybe a 20-year period, and in that 20-year period, the original owners don't object to that possession, then you can claim that property, or you can get an easement over that piece of land. And so that's sometimes given as the justification for claiming property in North America's adverse possession. Of course, there's a challenge with that, because in most cases, people who came from Europe weren't in quiet enjoyment of that land for a 20-year period, because there was constant resistance to and objections to people settling in that territory without treaty, without permission, without dealing with not only the indigenous peoples, but the land itself. So adverse possession, even under Western law, has a bit of a problem, because it wasn't quiet enjoyment, it wasn't occupation without objection, without resistance in many places. Well, some people say, well, if that's not how property is formed in North America, then it must be through this idea of conquest, that indigenous peoples were conquered by either war or the superior force of culture. We can look at that doctrine and also question that a bit. So first of all, particularly in northern North America, what became British North America, there were very few instances of declared war. There were wars in Atlantic Canada between the British and the Crown up until the 1750s, when peace and friendship treaties were signed. And those peace and friendship treaties didn't declare that the land was conquered in that instance. There were some wars up around the northern shore of Lake Huron in 1850, prior to the Robinson-Huron-Robinson-Superior treaties, armed skirmishes. There was also the Riel Rebellion, as you know about, in 1885. There was the Chilcotin War out here, as we'll talk about next Monday, in the 1850s as well. But for the most part, there wasn't a declaration of war. And most of the treaties and agreements that were signed didn't proceed on the way of conquest. So that is problematic for the Crown to be able to claim that they have property through conquest, because there never was such a thing. Secondly, even if there was conquest, the Law of Nations leaves intact the laws of the people, the land relationships, for instance, of the people in such time, until such time as they're clearly and plainly taken away. In other words, even if Aboriginal peoples were conquered, it would likely leave the land in their possession until such time as that land was clearly and plainly taken away. And that has occurred, as we're going to read in Calder, here in British Columbia, hasn't occurred in most places across the country. But we need to remember that there was no military conquest. I'm just saying, in the alternative, even if there was, that doesn't found rights to property for the Crown. Finally, this idea, well, maybe you weren't conquered by the force of arms, but you were conquered by the superiority of culture. This is the argument that was put forward by Justice McEachern in the Delgamuukw case in the 1990s. And this view was rejected by the Supreme Court. In fact, the Supreme Court in the, I think it's the Haida case, said Aboriginal peoples were never conquered. So, you know, doctrinally, the Supreme Court of Canada has rejected conquest. They rejected occupation and adverse possession, as we'll see when we look at the Jill Coton case, because they said land was never terra nullius.
Question. So, if they were never conquered through war, would they look at the fact that people were individually conquered through disease?
Okay, so there's the question about, so you weren't conquered through war, but maybe you were conquered because you just diminished away, given the numbers that we now have as non-Aboriginal peoples and the numbers that you have as Aboriginal peoples that diminished through disease. That's not a legal doctrine that would give rise to any rights in the Crown. You can have, like in England, one or two lords owning great estates that have vast territories that the rest of the population might not have rights to. And even if that hereditary lordship diminishes through time, those lands sort of don't, as long as there's one person left, escheat out of the family itself. So there would be problems just saying, well, you guys are too small in numbers to be able to claim lands here. That's not a legal argument that would necessarily or generally be accepted in law.
Were the papal bulls ever used in North America as a justification for the Doctrine of Discovery?
Yes. So there's the question is, were the papal bulls ever used in North America for a justification for the Doctrine of Discovery? Yes, which is this image in the background. So maybe it's not discovery, occupation, adverse possession, or conquest. Maybe it's just God saying to Europeans, you have a right to these lands which Indians, indigenous peoples own or live on or occupy or possess. And those papal bulls were used for that instance. That idea has been rejected in international law, the Western Sahara case, the Island of Palmas case. Most of the religious orders of the world have also rejected the claiming of the land by the basis of the Doctrine of Discovery. But some people would still hold to that view, that God must have had something to do with this withering away of Indians and having the land be transferred over to non-Indians. Then, so that, these are just, what are the justifications for us holding our property here in North America? Well, here's another one. The Indians ceded that land, or shared that land, or surrendered that land to other people. That seems, of all the justifications that we've been given so far, the one that's most likely to hold some weight, because you're actually involving the agency of Earth itself and the people who have been living on this Earth from time of memory, as they then transfer a portion of that, and then there's a question about what was transferred, but transfer a portion of that to subsequent peoples to be able to find a part of. What's I think attractive about that way of proceeding for founding property relationships in Canada is that it's democratic. It is respectful of the equality of peoples, perhaps. Or, in contrast to the others, it doesn't necessarily assume the inferiority of the Aboriginal peoples because of their so-called state of civilization and therefore could be overrun by these other doctrines. In other words, session to me seems like the doctrine that would be most consistent with a modern constitutional state. Try to work out relationships between peoples through agreement, through persuasion, through deliberation, through engagement, rather than through the force of arms or the force of doctrine that doesn't take account of the dignity of the people that were there beforehand. So I would put much more weight there. We can still critique that, as we're going to do, about what were the terms of session, how did session actually work out in its process, but at least there's something there. Questions or comments at that point? Then there's this other international standard, which is this recognition of the land as being Indigenous land. And through that recognition, delineating the territory under which those people identify their relationship, and then throwing up protection around it in international law. This is the standard of the American Declaration on the Rights of Man. This is the way that the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples is proceeding. There are countries in the world, Malaysia, Belize, etc., where there's been orders by the court just to recognize and delineate. Forget all these other justifications, just recognize that it's Indigenous land, and then proceed with your property regimes, your relationships to land on that basis. And so there's a contrast there, right, between here, Indigenous people's relationships to land, and the relationships of land that we might now all claim a root to. Yes?
What does it mean to proceed on that basis?
Proceed on the basis, so the question is, what does it mean to proceed on the basis of?
So there's recognition of it being Indigenous people's land, and
yes,
then to proceed on that basis.
Yes.
That's the second part.
So the question is, what does it mean to proceed on the basis that you recognize, delineate, and protect land? You could say in British Columbia that the Shwetnik territory has never been properly gazetted, held by non-Aboriginal peoples because they never gave it away. We reject the doctrine of discovery of those lands by the British Crown, occupation, adverse possession, or conquest. There's been no cession. So you could picture saying, that's Shwetnik land. Here's how we would then delineate it. Here's how it's described in law, and here's the protection that it would get, which is it's recognized and affirmed. Can't be extinguished anymore. It can't even be infringed without this high justificatory standard. That's the kind of delineation that was talked about in the late 2000s, about 2009, when there was a discussion about passing an Aboriginal Title Recognition Act, which is to somehow create a process for just recognizing and affirming, not extinguishing, not infringing, and do it through legislation. And what would happen, you would presume, is that there would be a registry that would be set up that would take applications from the different Indigenous bodies. It'd be the best if it could be under international oversight, but nevertheless, you would take those applications, you would have that registry set forward. And then, if you wanted to have other people get it, you could follow the Royal Proclamation process, other processes for securing a sharing of or a cession of that land. That's happening in other parts of the world. The Native Title Act in Australia does a little bit of that in the way that it's set out. So, there was a question a moment ago about symbolic acts. in trying to pursue this idea of the laws of nations. And so in the materials here, again, I didn't have you read it, but this occurred time and time again. Here's a picture of someone representing Jacques Cartier's visit to the Gaspé Peninsula in 1534. And what you can see is a title being raised there with, which is a mast. On the top of the mast are three fleurs-de-lis, and on top of the fleurs-de-lis are some words about, you know, long live the king. And so this is showing that there's a kind of a claim to land being made here as the French sailed in to that territory. But now let's hear the words of Jacques Cartier in this. This is on 196, if you want to follow along. Again, I didn't ask you to read this, I just wanted to fill in some background. It says, on the 25th of the month, we caused a fair high cross to be made of the height of 30 feet, which was made in the presence of many of them, meaning the Indians, upon the point of the entrance of the said haven, Gaspé, in the midst whereof we hanged up a shield with three fleurs-de-lis in it, and on the top was carved in the wood with antique letters this phrase, Vive le roi de France. Then before them all, we set it upon the said point for all the Indians. So soon as it was up, we all together kneeled down before them, with our hands towards heaven, yielding God thanks. And we made signs unto them, shewing them the heavens, and that all our salvation dependeth only on him in which in them dwelleth. And so they set this up, they knelt, they had a prayer, the Mi'kmaq, Passamaquoddy, Maliseet, others were gathered on. And it continues. And after we were returned to our ships, their captains, clad with an old bearskin, with three of their sons and a brother with them, came unto us in one of their boats. And there he made a long oration unto us, and shewing us the cross we had set up, and then making a cross with his two fingers. Then did he show us all the country about us, as if he would say that all this was his, and that we should not set up any cross without his leave. So here's this confrontation, you know, as they pulled up with their boats to Jacques Cartier's boat. So what does Cartier do? Then did we shew them with signs that the cross was but only set up to be a light and a leader, which ways to enter into the port, and that we would shortly come again. But it's, oh no, we're not claiming discovery of your land. We're not claiming this is your land. This is like a navigation marker, a beacon, to allow us to know how to proceed next time we come in. Prevarication, perhaps, in this account, changing the story for the Mi'kmaq to one thing, and then when you go back to France, another kind of claim is being made, not just about being a navigational marker, but King has these rights now in New France. We also see the same thing occurring not only in Northern and North America, it also happens in South America. This is a depiction here on the PowerPoint of the conquistadores coming to places that are now called Brazil or the islands. Well, there was another kind of proclamation, a requirement that the King of Spain insisted on because of the papal bulls when Indians were being encountered. In order to make good the title of the Spanish king, this legal document had to be read out, and a notary had to be present to verify that this kind of claim was occurring, and it's called the requerimiento, and it's on 197 of your materials, and I'm just going to read portions of this as well. So here's what was necessary to claim title. On the parts of the king, Don Ferdinando and Dona Juana, his daughter, Queen of Castile and Leon, subduers of the barbarous nations. We servants notify and make known to you as best we can that the Lord our God, living and eternal, created the earth, and the earth and one man and one woman of you and I and all the men of the world were in our descendants. But on account of this multitude which has sprung up from this man and woman 5,000 years hence, the world was created, and it was necessary that some men go one way and some another, and that the world should be divided into many kingdoms. And of all the nations, God, our Lord, gave charge to one man called Saint Peter, that he should be the Lord and superior of all men. Next paragraph. And he commanded him to place his seat in Rome. And then there was a pope that was charged with looking over the world. And now the fourth paragraph. One of these pontiffs, one of these popes, made donation of these isles and terra firm to the aforesaid king and queen, to their successors and our lords, with all that are in these territories. So the pope made donation of North America to the Spanish crown. And so these lands are there. And then I'm about the mid of the second to last paragraph. Wherefore, as best we can, we ask and require you that you consider what we have said to you, which is that you give up your lands, and that you take the time that shall be necessary to understand and deliberate upon it, and acknowledge the church as the ruler and superior of the whole world, and the high priest called Pope, and in his name the king and queen, as superior and lords of these islands, and this terra firma, by virtue of the said donation. And if you do so, all will be well with you. But then over the page, the last paragraph, but if you do not do this, if you don't recognize this land is the God's land given by the Pope to the king, if you do not do this, and wickedly and intentionally delay to do so, I certify to you that with the help of God we shall forcibly enter into your country, and shall make war with you, and against you in all ways and manners that we can, and shall subject you to the yoke of obedience and obedience of the church and their highness. And we shall take you and your wives and children, and shall make slaves of them, and as such shall sell and dispose of them, as their highnesses may command. And we shall take away your goods, and shall do all the harm and damages that we can. Not a pretty picture. But then, here's the clincher. And we protest that if you don't do this, the deaths and losses which shall accrue to you from this are your fault, and not that of their highnesses or of ours or their cavalries which come with us. So we request that the notary here present give us his testimony in writing that you witness that this requirement has now sort of been verified.
Did they have interpreters?
Did they have interpreters?
With any kind of accuracy?
So there was often not interpreters that were there. There was often not the ability to be able to understand. In fact, here's a commentary from Lewis Hanke, a historian. The requirement was read to trees and empty huts when no Indians were to be found. It sounds like Monty Python, right? Captains muttered its theological phrases into their beards on the edge of sleeping Indian settlements, or even a league away before starting a formal attack. And at times, some leather-lunged Spanish notary hurled its sonorous phrases after the Indians as they fled into the mountains. It's funny, it wasn't so tragic. People's life and death was being adjudicated on the basis of the requerimiento, and of course their land was being transferred to another just on these assertions. Now we might think, what does that have to do with present working through Aboriginal title in Canada? Well, it partly has to do with some of these roots. There was, as the Prospero case said, there was from the outset never any doubt that underlying title vested in the crown. Where does that no doubt come from? Perhaps through some of these things, or perhaps through this Royal Proclamation of 1763. It's a kind of requirimento. It's a kind of erecting of a symbol. If you read the proclamation, it says, whereas we have taken into our royal consideration the extensive and valuable acquisitions in America secured to our crown by the late definitive Treaty of Paris. It's our land. We got it through treaty. And our, we proclaim to you, whereas it is just and reasonable and essential to our interest and the securities of our quality colonies that the several nations or tribes of Indians with whom we are connected and whom live on our, under our protection should not be molested or disturbed in the possession of our dominions and territories. So the Royal Proclamation speaks in mixed languages, right? We're not going to molest you and disturb you in your possessions of our territories. We didn't necessarily hurl a requirimento at you or erect a cross, but there's something in the proclamation that seems to have kickstarted a wave of transferring title away from Aboriginal peoples to the crown on an assumption of some kind of inferiority or difference on the part of the Indians. In other words, how did the crown get this land? We conquered the French on the plains of Abraham, but the Indians, remember, they were just allies. You also might remember when that conquest of New France occurred, most of the British forts fell into the Indian hands. They, as the British won the war against France, but in 1763 they didn't have the land. But the proclamation somehow comes into that other kind of view. Remember, we're telling two stories, an intersocial story. And this is what's lying on that on the common law side of the story that it's been struggling with to try to appropriately address in this legal system, because there's a recognition that a lot of this is built on questionable foundations. Comments, further observations?
So when you look at trying to justify or make right or whatever you want to call it, when you look at ownership of land, and there's a phrase, I believe, that says once flawed, always flawed.
Yeah, so you're asking foundational questions, which is what I'm doing here, about our law related to property. If there's a flaw in the initial grant from the Crown to the way, like, I hold my property 5 houses off campus here, or someone else holds their property in the Shawetmek territory, what's the nature of that Crown grant? Is that Crown grant somehow perfected along the way? Can the Crown give what it doesn't have to other peoples? And if it can, how can it do that? And if it can't, what are the consequences of that? These are the questions, the big questions of Aboriginal title and Aboriginal rights in Canada, and why it's very important to see the foundations to try to work as best we can, as the court says, to create a kind of reconciliation. So, that's the framework. We haven't even started to talk about the cases yet, but the cases illustrate this framework. So the first case in the materials is the St. Catharines Milling and Lumber Company case versus the Queen. This is the boundaries here of Treaty 3 that are basically outlined on the map. It's called the Northwest Angle of what is now Ontario. It actually proceeds a little bit into what is now Manitoba as well. The south is the Lake of the Woods area. We're mostly in this area in Anishinaabe country. Ojibwe people, the people that I've been talking about, my family is from and connected with. So these Ojibwe people were asked in the 1870s if they would be willing to allow a road to go across this land because there was a settlement out in the Red River. And you know, you could get to the end of the lakehead, and then you would need to start overland to be able to get to what's now Winnipeg, the Red River area. And they said no. The Ojibwe said, no, we don't want a road going through our territory. Because they were quite happy just to charge tolls on their own terms, right? And get the money as people were coming across. Why should we give you a road when we can get compensated for every person that walks across or canoes across this territory? But the government was insistent that a treaty be signed, and so they sent another set of negotiators out with them. We're going to read about this in a couple of weeks when we deal with the Grassy Narrows case. It's going to be a case that deals with the same territory. And eventually there's an agreement. The nature of the agreement is still somewhat disputed, but an agreement between the Anishinaabe and the Crown to be able to come to some kind of revised relationship with this land. But there's some wording in the negotiations that are in English, but we have access to the Ojibwe understanding, at least refracted, about how they thought about their land. So this is on page 313 of the materials. Mawadopanes says, "We think it's a great thing to meet here with you. And what we heard yesterday as you represented yourself, you said the Queen sent you here. The way we understood you as a representative of the Queen." And then here's the wording about land. "All this is our property, where you have come. We understood that you yesterday, that Her Majesty has given you the same authority as she has." So we understand we're dealing with the Queen's representative. "But we want you to know the Great Spirit has planted us on this ground, where we are as you were where you came from. We think where we are is our property. I will tell you what he said to us when he planted us here, the rules which we should follow, us Indians. He has given us rules that we should follow to govern us rightly." In other words, there's a Anishinaabe law that they have to be able to help them govern their relationships with these lands as they regard this as their property. The next chief speaks to the chief after. "We would not wish anyone to smile at our affairs, as we think our country, is a large matter to us." And then over the page on 314, the third paragraph from the bottom, "My terms I'm going to lay down before you. The decision of our chiefs, ever since we came to a decision, you push it back." In other words, he doesn't like the way the Crown is being pushy about coming to these terms. He says, "The sound of the rustling of the gold is under my feet where I stand. We have a rich country. It is the Great Spirit who gave us this. Where we stand upon is the Indians' property, and it and belongs to them." So there's strong statements about what the nature of their relationship to land is. Strong statements about their conceptions of so-called property. And they understand the mineral wealth as a part of this property. So in the St. Catharines Milling and Lumber Company case, there's an interpretation about what is the effect of the Indians, in the Crown's word, surrender of these lands to the Crown. The Dominion government thinks that upon the surrender of these lands, the land is now Dominion land. And so it gives a lease to the St. Catharines Milling and Lumber Company to start timbering, engaging in forestry in this area. Ontario says, "Wait a second. The land that you took that surrender from, and now given a lease to a corporation to timber, is actually not Dominion land. when the land was surrendered, the beneficial interest vests in the Crown Right of Ontario, not in the Crown in the Right of Canada. And so the Ontario Attorney General, the Premier, they bring an action to ask for three or four things. One, a declaration that the Dominion has no rights over that land or for the timber. An injunction preventing the company from trespassing on those lands and taking any timber off of it. An injunction against the removal of the timber already cut. And a decree for damages. So Ontario says the effect of the so-called surrender of this land is to vest the beneficial interest in the land in the province, not in the federal government.
So when this was happening in 1888, mm-hmm. was the Indian Act?
So the Indian Act was in place in 1876 and had been in operation for just a couple of years. We also know that the Ontario boundary was in flux, moving from an initial boundary that was much closer to Lake Superior. And it wasn't clear at a certain point before this moment whether or not this was even going to be Ontario or Manitoba's land or a new province that would be created there.
So had Ottawa already transferred the governance of land to the provinces?
So that's the question that we're asking in this case. Who has the right to this land in 1888 when it's been surrendered? Does the federal government have the right to this land, or does the province have the right to this land? That's the question being asked, and the court's going to give an answer, which is it's the province that has the right to the beneficial interest in the land. So when it's so-called surrendered, it's not up to the Dominion government to then use it. It's only the province that could use the land after that so-called surrender of the land. And we're going to look at the reasons for that, but that's the facts, that's the issue here. Who gets the benefit of the surrender? The province. Decision? The province gets the benefit of that surrender. Now, when you read through the opinion, in coming to that conclusion, the court first has to ask, well, what about the nature of the Indians' interest in that land? Either before the treaty or after the treaty. And in examining this question, you do not get reference to what I just quoted there in the Privy Council. You don't get a sense of the Anishinaabe understanding of relationship to land. In fact, what the court says is that the Indians only have a right to land because of the Royal Proclamation, and that's a right that's contingent on the Royal Proclamation. The Crown could withdraw at any moment the right of the Indians to have land if it withdrew the terms of the proclamation. So I'm reading now about 10 lines up, maybe 12 or 15 lines up even, on the bottom of page 212, the Indian inhabitants had land surrendered by the treaty. Their possession, such as it was, can only be ascribed to the general provisions made in the Royal Proclamation. The Indians, now about 8 or 9 lines from the bottom, the Indians' nature of land was personal and usufructory, and dependent on the goodwill of the sovereign. So the Indians' lands, personal meaning it only resides in them. They can't transfer an Indian interest in land to somebody who's non-Indian, personal interest in land. It's also usufructory interest, which means it's like a right to take the fruits from the soil. It's like a license to pick and gather. So it's personal, it can't be transferred, and it's like they've been given permission by the Crown to hunt, fish, and gather berries. It's usufructory. They only have the usufruct interest. And in fact, the Royal Proclamation expressly says that this lands are part of our dominions and territories. And it's only for the present that we allow the Indians to have these personal and usufructuary rights. And then over the top of page 213, it appears to them, sufficient for the purposes, that there's been all along vested in the crown a substantial and paramount estate underlying the Indian title, which became plenum dominium whenever that title was surrendered or otherwise extinguished. Here's the doctrine of discovery, terra nullius, adversus of occupation, something like this going on. Because what's being said here is that even when the Indians were in occupation of land under the Royal Proclamation, and they only had land because the Crown said they had land under the Royal Proclamation, underlying that all along was a substantial and paramount estate that resided in the Crown. In other words, the Crown owns the land. The Indians have this license by virtue of the proclamation. And whenever that Indian interest is extinguished, this full paramount estate, benefits of that estate accrue to the province, not the federal government. So this is, how did the Crown get the underlying title? Royal Proclamation.
But in what you read, it talked about dominion.
So what it's saying though is this underlying title became the full plenum dominion. So the Crown has dominion here prior to the title being so-called extinguished. And when the Indian interest is surrendered, the Crown takes the whole thing. But the Crown restrained itself prior to taking, the Crown restrained itself before that through the Royal Proclamation from having everything. But if the Royal Proclamation wasn't there, they would have had it all. Because it's only in this case, it's only the Royal Proclamation that creates the Indian title. Not the Indians, not their possession, use, and occupation. That is not the view of the Privy Council. So we're seeing, I think, some of the echoes of what was put on the board earlier about the symbolic acts and the effects that they might have in the present in transferring to the Crown these rights and undermining, literally undermining, through a paramount estate, the fact that they have underlying, that is, the Crown has underlying title. And to further support this conclusion, the court says in 1840, this land was, any benefits that would have accrued to the sale of land if it was given by the Indians to the Crown would have gone to the province of Canada. Remember, Canada was united at that point. And in 1867, when the Constitution Act was promulgated, Section 109 of the Constitution Act allowed the beneficial interest to continue with the former possessors. So the province was divided into two, into Quebec and to Upper Canada, and they continue to get the benefit of those lands. Section 109 of the Constitution is on the top of page 214. The kind of middle of 214. All lands, mines, minerals, and royalties belonging to the several provinces of Canada, plus Nova Scotia and New Brunswick, at the Union, shall belong to the several provinces. So the things that belong to the provinces prior to Union, belong to the provinces after Union. The court's making the argument that the Indian interest would have been something that could have been taken by the province before union, therefore can be received by the province after union. Note they don't look at the effect of these language, this language, that is the provinces take these interests, subject to any trusts existing thereof, and to any interest other than that of the province in the same. Could have considered the Indian interest to be a trust. Could have also considered it to be an interest other than the province in the same. In fact, when we come to the Delgamuukw decision, the court's going to read this more favorably in regard to the First Nations. But where this is the first case, this is the early case, this case stands for the proposition, again, that the beneficial interest in so-called surrendered lands go to the province, not to the Dominion government. The reason is because the Crown has a paramount title. Indians' interest is dependent on the Crown, and the Crown has organized its affairs in such a way that the province itself, through Section 109, gets to continue to enjoy the beneficial interests of lands that they had prior to Confederation. And it doesn't matter that Indians and lands reserved for Indians under Section 9124 is given to the federal government, because the court is saying that's only a power to administer Indian affairs, even though it says Indians and lands reserved for Indians. It's not actually a federal power to hold those lands more broadly. So that's St. Catharines. Any questions or comments there? It's a very confusing decision to read.
So the fiduciary relationship, was that discussed, or was it just considered that it was housed in 9124?
Yeah, so there was no fiduciary relationship discussed here, and you really don't get that as a legal duty until 1984 with the Garand case. In fact, there's a case that says maybe there's a kind of a political obligation, but it wasn't even considered justiciable.
So this is all premised on the royal proclamation. Doesn't that kind of undercut the principle of the proclamation that that you're supposed to, that you know, indigenous people won't be treated poorly because, or as poorly as regards land, because the crown is so far away?
Mm-hmm.
That idea of splitting the dealings with land as being, you know, better done from far away than done by the actual
people. That's right. So the question is, doesn't the way the court is interpreting the Royal Proclamation here undermine some of the purposes of the Royal Proclamation? Because now you get the benefit of the land being transferred directly to the people that are most likely to be able to secure profit from it. And yes, it is the case that the Dominion government is entering into the negotiations. So there is a more distant government dealing with them through the negotiation process, but then at the end of the negotiations, the local government is the one that benefits rather than the more distant government. So it does cut away against some of that checks and balancing feature. I want to make sure we get the Calder case in here, last 10 minutes or so that we have. So here we're dealing with the Nisga'a people in the Naas Valley. We've already talked about them when we looked at the Campbell case and talked about the governance agreements. And the question that the Nisga pose for the court is they ask for a declaration that their title has never been extinguished. And so the question for the courts here is, first of all, is there any such thing as Aboriginal title in law? And then secondly, if there is such a thing as Aboriginal title, has this title been extinguished? Prior to 1973, there's case law to suggest that if there is any interest that Indians have in the land, it's again just personal usufructory, dependent on the goodwill of the sovereign, therefore they don't have title. They might have some political claim to land or treaties, but nothing vests in them. And so, in fact, it was thought that dealing with Indian issues wasn't justiciable, wasn't something that could be tried in court to be able to ask for a declaration of title. because there was no legal interest. Indians didn't have a legal interest in their land. It's Crown land, not Indian land. So that's one of the questions. Is there title? And then secondly, if there is title, has it been extinguished? The court, six judges come to the conclusion that title exists in Canadian law, that title is a justiciable interest, that title is something that the Indians hold. And six of the judges agree with that point. And then three judges on the one side with Judson, argue that that title has been extinguished as of 1973. And three judges say that title has not been extinguished. So all the judges recognize that Aboriginal title is an interest in law. And then there's an even division about whether or not that title has been extinguished in British Columbia. And then what you get is the seventh judge, Justice Pigeon, who doesn't join with either of these judgments, but writes a separate judgment that says, in law, in British Columbia, if you want to sue the Crown, you have to get permission to sue the Crown. You need to get a fiat to sue the Crown. In other words, in British Columbia, the Crown has sovereign immunity. And if they don't want to be sued, they don't have to be sued. They could only be sued if their permission was given. And Justice Pigeon says that permission was never given to the NISCA to sue them. And then the judges on Justice Judson's side also come to that same conclusion. So the NISCA do not succeed here in this case because they never got permission to sue. The Crown's own sovereign immunity prevents this case from being heard. And Justice Pigeon, on page 236 of the material, says, plaintiff's claim is barred by sovereign immunity from suit without a fiat. So, it's a technicality, right? The case is thrown out on that technicality. But you've got this powerful obiter now from the Supreme Court of Canada that Aboriginal title exists, and that half of the court thinks it's not even been extinguished. Now, what are the arguments for title existing? First of all, Justice Judson, in hearing the academics like Wilson Duff, recognizes that there's ownership and definition in relationship to territory, recognizing the NISCA claims, 1888 there, David McKay says, what we don't like about the government is they're saying this, well, we'll give you this much land. How can they give it when it is our own? We cannot understand it. They've never bought it from our forefathers. They have never fought and conquered our people and taken the land in that way, and yet they now say that they will give us this land, our own land. So both academic commentary and Aboriginal commentary is recognized as giving rise to right to land. In fact, Justice Judson says, I do not take the proclamation to be the exclusive source of Indian title. This is on page 219. It is clear, in fact, that Indian title in British Columbia cannot owe its origin to the proclamation of 1763. So it's overturning St. Catherine's on that point. Indian title is not dependent on the Royal Proclamation. What is it dependent on? The bottom of 219. The fact is that when the settlers came, the Indians were there, organized in societies, and occupying the land as their forefathers had done for centuries. This is what Indian title means. And then Justice Hall picks up on the same points and says that the Niskahav possession itself, that's proof of ownership, also makes the point that this title is not vested, or not rooted in the proclamation. So, Indian title, now in 1973, is an independent legal interest. It doesn't owe its source to Crown proclamation. It owes its source to that other prong that I started out with this morning, right? And indigenous conceptions of land, time, identity, animacy, ceremony, kinship. That's where this stuff we're studying comes from, not the Crown's proclamation. But then there's a disagreement about extinguishment. The Crown, Justin says, extinguished title through the Douglas Treaties, through eight proclamations, four ordinances, terms of union, also, he said, extinguished land, and then the creation of reserves extinguished land. There's so much more to say about this, but maybe next class we deal with Delgamuukw, and next class with Chilcotin, we'll fill in more of this legal history. On the other side, Justice Hall says there's no extinguishment because there's no treaties. Right? Whereas Justice Judson would have read the treaties much broader, the Douglas Treaty. Justice Hall says there's nothing that ever took that way, that land away. The Royal Proclamation didn't take it away. That legislation didn't take it away. In fact, these proclamations were on the vires of the beyond the vires of the colony to be able to even extinguish Aboriginal land. Right. So it was beyond the authority of the colony of British Columbia, the colony of Vancouver Island, to extinguish Indian land. And then after Confederation, it's only the federal government that's vested with the authority for dealing with Indians and lands reserved for Indians. So the provincial government cannot extinguish Aboriginal title after 1871. Because if they singled out Indians and lands reserved for Indians, that would be beyond the provincial authority. So the province couldn't extinguish it after Confederation, and the colony of British Columbia or Vancouver Island couldn't extinguish it before Confederation. Therefore, it exists, it has a continuity, Aboriginal title has a continuity with its pre-existing recognition. I know there's a lot more to say here, but we're going to linger with the Delgamuukw case and spend a whole class on Delgamuukw, and then we're going to linger next Monday on Chilcotin and spend a whole class on Chilcotin and hopefully fill in some more of this stuff about extinguishment. But thanks, that's it for today.